Movie House Cinemas, proud sponsors of Conversations with Gerry Kelly. Treat yourself to a movie. Relax in VIP recliner seating without the VIP price tag. At Cityside, Glengormley, Macara, and Coleraine. Enjoy the show.
Good evening and welcome to Conversations with me, Gerry Kelly. My guest this evening is one of the most successful singer-songwriters to come out of Northern Ireland. He's travelled the world with his music, with his own unique style and with his equally unique voice. He's just recorded his 18th album and I'm truly delighted to welcome the fabulous Brian Kennedy.
Thank you, Gerry.
I, perhaps, should have introduced you as Dr. Brian Kennedy.
Because why did you not?
Because I'd forgotten. Back in 2006, the Ulster University gave you...
I was kind of floored by that nearly, because I know that they don't just hand them out at the top of Victoria Square, do they? It was a really lovely... There's nothing like your own city saying to you, we really appreciate what you've done and what you're continuing to do. So when that call came through, I was so honoured. And I went along with it. I had to get into the gear and everything and go to the waterfront hall. Now, normally I'm in the waterfront hall singing or do something like that, but it was really surreal and lovely.
Do you use it? Do you use the title?
Not only do I use it, it's on my credit card.
No.
If I had it here, I'd show you. Because they did. They actually sort of took me to task lately and said, now, we hope you use this to the fullness of its, what exactly did they say to me? Something like, you know, use it to your advantage in the most positive way. Because again, they said, we don't just hand these out for fun. You've earned this. And it is quite something to come from the Falls Road and be educated very minimally, really. I mean, they did their best, God love them. And then to end up with a doctorate of a D-Lit in literature and music.
I think that's fabulous. So what you said was school days, were they not happy days?
School days were very, very challenging days. You know, we're talking about, I'm 57, right? So 1966, when I appeared into the world. By the time I'm 10, 11, 12, we're into the 70s. We're into, as we know, the well-trodden historical path of unrest, of murder, of discord, everything. And so we grew up in the middle of that, thinking that was normal. It's so funny and funny in a terrible way when people are talking about Gaza and things like that now. And somebody said recently to me, imagine being, pulled out of your house and, all of that and being evacuated. And I said, well, I don't have to imagine. I remember that.
Do you remember it well?
Oh, very
much. How did it influence you?
I remember my auntie, who's no longer with us, just was trying to kind of wake me up, but not wake me up and bring me up to the local school gymnasium, where we would have normally gathered as schoolboys. And during the night, there was a raid. And she said, now you be quiet. And the weirdest thing of all was seeing our neighbours in like one big curler in their hair and their house coat and maybe ill-fitting tights and wee old slippers. And you would never see your neighbours like that. So suddenly we're all standing around in our kind of badly put together pajamas, all of us, all huddled up, stripy sheets, trying to stay warm. And that happened more than once, absolutely.
Had you any awareness of what was actually going on?
No, I mean, every day when I went to school, I had a British soldier point a gun at me and do that kind of thing where they'd try and kind of make you freak you out. Then they'd say really disgusting things about your mother or your sister, just to try and get a rise out of you. Things like that. So I was well aware that we were occupied by British soldiers in that part of the world. Then, of course, the turnstiles at the end of the Falls Road were another way of it. I remember when Mary McAleese was taken to task when people were saying that she was exaggerating, that we were ghettoised as young people. And, of course, that was a perfect example of how we were ghettoised in terms of having to queue up. Can you imagine it now? You're going into the city centre and I have to queue up at a turnstile. And then way before computers or anything like that, in the lashing rain like today, they'd say, what's your name? Where are you coming from? Where are you going to? How long will you be in the town for? What are you doing? Where do you live? What did your parents do? And that was just me as a little kid. So that's when I started to harmonise with the ambulances and all the things I used to start
to do. Is it true that you actually harmonised with the fire brigade and with the ambulance sirens that were coming up the road?
I suppose it must speak to the amount of them that were around at the time. But also, if you think about the proximity of Royal Victoria Hospital, really close to where I grew up, and for some reason, when I heard the Nino Nino, my instant reaction to it was, I want a nice harmony. And I think of a higher note or a lower note. Now, if I was a therapist, I would say to a much older Brian Kennedy, I would say, well, you know what you were doing there, don't you? And I'd say, what? And he'd say, you know, whenever I feel afraid, like the film, I whistle a happy tune. I try and somehow get the fear out of it by making it less fearful, by making it musical. And little did I know my voice would be the thing that would propel me into the world. Yeah. It's an extraordinary thing, really.
Everybody was going through what you described there.
Yeah.
But were you happy as such?
No. I have to say that mostly I was not. I was one of those wee kids that really, from a very early age, thought to myself, I must have been mixed up at the hospital. Do you know what I mean? There was my fantasy, I hate to say it, but I will say it because it's honest. My fantasy, if I was particularly upset, was that I'd sit on the step of the house, the wee red step, and my fantasy would be that my real parents would come along in a car and put me on the back seat in a blanket and take me away to my real family.
Your real parents?
This is in my head.
Yeah.
Right? Because, of course, I did have real parents.
But why did you think real parents would come?
Well, I think because I was, the home that I grew up in was, I think about it now, first of all, my parents were kids when they had us. They were little Catholic kids also, really under the thumb of the Catholic Church, and then the occupation and the war and so on. And so it was a very, very, very difficult, turbulent time. I still think to this day, you know, that people suffer from PTSD from those times, even now. And even now when I think of certain things, I'm the kind of person that really thinks, my first thought is, what's the worst can happen? How can I get out of that? How will it be okay? And then eventually I'll calm down. And that stood me in good stead when my health went sideways. But yeah, I think that it was a very difficult house to grow up in. There was a lot of violence on the street. There was some violence inside the house too.
Really?
Toward
you?
Oh yeah. I mean, can you imagine how annoying I was? Little kind of kid humming around the house and all of that. And also I was naturally cheeky. We call it that. I was bright. I was also sensitive. I also was a feminist before I knew what that word meant, because I couldn't understand why my mother had to go out and clean all these pensioners' houses and come back and have to clean our house and cook for all of us. And the only reason the boys didn't have to do it is because they were boys. I didn't understand it. So therefore, I would challenge everybody, including my father. Didn't go down well. And so I went on, I was such a drama queen when I think of it now. I mean, I would kind of refuse to let my mother cook any food for me at all. I lived on Weetabix for 2.5 years. Weetabix. I'm not making that up. I would have that for lunch and dinner just so as my mother didn't have to cook. Or I would do the dishes, or I just really somehow tuned into her plight and all the other women around me. Because as we know, Northern Irish men of that time, either they were working and gone for ages, or, I mean, the best crack is when you're with all the women. And then they'd forget that I was there. I'd get behind the sofa or something, and then you didn't really hear what was going on, you know. So for me, it was always about, I always was tuned into that feminine frequency.
So you felt different from even a very young age?
Really, really. And also not only that, I was told I was different. So interesting that I stuck out, and then therefore people would say, would you just, you're a girl. Imagine the worst thing you could be called is a girl. It's so misogynistic to begin with. Never mind. But yeah, from the get-go, people would say, shut up, you're only a girl anyway. You're a blouse, you're all these...
Would this have happened at school as well?
Particularly at school.
Particularly at school.
I mean, I went to an all-boys school on the, you know, St. Paul's on the Falls, and that was all about fighting and football, the end. And I couldn't do either of those two things. But I certainly could somehow hold a wee tune to myself.
But why did you think you were different? Because you like girly things or what?
I really like girly things. I also realized that I also had crushes on other boys, and I didn't know what that was. But unfortunately, by the time I got to church, old enough to go to chapel every week and old enough to listen to the pulpit, of course, they were preaching that was a deadly sin. That was against God, and you'd be punished and ended up in hell.
Yeah.
And I actually felt just as sorry for straight people, because I think you weren't even allowed to be straight back then, never mind anything else. So there was that strange thing where I got really good at hiding who I was, like a ninja. I got a ninja at it. And so therefore I was able to have this outward life and cope well with everything. And I could read a situation like that and go, that person needs to hear this, that person needs to hear that. So I got really good at having an internal secret life. And that's not a very healthy thing. Mm. It's good if you're a writer, maybe. So I got used to living inside myself a lot. I got used to knowing from a very early age, you're on your own.
You went to live with your grandmother.
I did.
What happened there? Why did you go to her?
Well, we had two sets of grannies, and one was in Anderson's Town, and my late brother Bap went to live with her at an early age. And then Granny Nellie, who lived in Beachmont around the corner, she just had really poor health. She had terrible deaths in the family. She had a whole kind of issue with alcohol and so on. And so oftentimes she would fall out of bed during the night, freezing cold.
This is the one you would
stay with? This is the one I eventually went to live with. And so I was strong enough to pick her up off the floor and put her back into the bed if she fell out during the night. And so I became her kind of carer for a while. And my bed was here. There was a wee window and there was her bed. And it was so cold, I slept in my school uniform, right? Because then I could get up really quickly. But the trickiest part was in between the window, my bed and her bed, there was a commode for the exclusive use of Granny at any time of the day or night. And so, of course, I'd be like, you know, under the blankets like this, going, oh, Jesus, here we go. But again, I saw it like I was being useful. It suited everybody. I was out of the main house because I was just in trouble all the time, fighting with everybody, answering back all the time. People just weren't used to a little kid saying, but why do you have to work and scrub the floors because you're a woman? Why? Why can't daddy do that? Why can't my brothers do that? And it, after a while, I suppose it was just like, would you ever just get him out of here? It was easier if I was just out of there.
Yeah, yeah.
And then somehow, Gerry, this wee voice appeared. And I started to sing along with the radio and ambulances. And then that was a complete, it was like a spell had been cast nearly. Where anytime I heard anything like ABBA or Kate Bush, I was mesmerized by music. In the middle of all of that craziness, even Kate Bush got through the Falls Road, even Meatloaf, even the Beatles. But I do remember when John Lennon was shot dead in 1980, they kept referring to him as an ex-Beatle, and I thought that was one word. I remember thinking, well, what's an ex-Beatle? I didn't understand what that was for ages, and then eventually, of course, he was an ex-Beatle. And then I became a big fan and I grew up and I met Paul McCartney and did all kinds of things like that. So amazingly, music came to the rescue.
I'm dismayed to hear when you talk about the violence that was at home.
But I think it's very commonplace, you know. I know that there are people out there who are going, no, that never happened to our house. And that's wonderful. I think that my people were very, very, very frustrated. Imagine going out into the world as a wee Catholic, having to go through that turnstile. Treated like dirt just to go and pay an electric bill or something.
That was the norm. We all did that.
Right. I mean, yeah, my auntie would say the same thing. She ended up in England and she said, look, I never lifted a finger to any of my kids. Yeah. So some people dealt with it well. All I can say about it really is that old cliche, which is, you know, hurt people. I think some of my relatives were really, really badly damaged and some of them weren't. Some of them escaped it.
So did you have all relationships cut with Mum and Dad?
Slowly but surely that happened. It was, yeah, it just was easier for everybody involved. And then how weird that I get a wee bit famous. So then I'm on the TV and releasing records and people like you were playing me and talking about me. And I think that was very strange. So I did used to include them in as much as I could. But in a way that even that didn't really work. It was too stressful. I could tell you lots of things off air that I can't tell you on air.
Well,
yeah.
Your escape was through your music, obviously.
Yes.
And let's move it on. You went off to London. What age were you when you went off to London?
18. I mean, 1985, July 11th, I was on that plane. I cashed my dole, bought a single ticket to London, July 11th. July 13th was Live Aid, 2 days later. Blistering sunshine. And I remember looking at, we had a wee TV out in the garden, in the squat that we were in Tottenham, two doors up with the Wonderful Adventures, that band. And we did a whole power cable thing and, you know, somehow made the meter work and all of that. There was maybe about 10 of us in that wee house.
So you were living there, no money?
No money, not a penny. A sleeping bag on the floor in an illegal house. We took over this house illegally called the squat. You probably can't do it anymore. And then, like I say, Live Aid happened. So it was like the world was having a party when we were there.
But how good were you at the singing at that stage?
I think I was starting to get good.
Did you go to London to try and make money through your singing?
I went to London to be a singer, definitely. I was actually the lead singer in my brother's band at that time.
And Bob's band.
Bob had already moved a few months before to London. The Adventures were from here. So we had proof that it was possible to come from Northern Ireland and do something musically. And they were signed to a guy called Simon Fuller.
Yes.
Who was managing them. Yes. That's how I met Simon. Yes. So it was a wonderful kind of leg up for us in those fairly squalid, you know, surroundings. But you know, everything looks great in the sunshine, doesn't it? When it's a really beautiful summer's day, even a horrible squat in Tottenham.
And did you, were you out busking? How are you getting your money?
I remember, excuse me, I'm getting over a cold. I remember we had the classic kind of Uncle Frank in London who'd gone to London and did very well with the building company and Auntie Alice. So they decided they'd get us a job on the building site, right? So me and Bap go to the building site the day before. This was my idea, of course, just to make sure we knew where it was. We weren't going to be late and shame Uncle Frank. And it was an Angel in Islington. And I remember looking into this building site that was, you know, all craters beneath the earth. And I just thought, I'm going to die if I go in there. There's no way I'm going to survive that. Fair play to anybody who does it. It's an amazing hard job.
Not for you.
But I remember that was a real moment in my life when I thought, I haven't come to London to do that. I've come to London to sing. And I'm a great visualizer. So I visualized myself singing all the time. I visualized my posters. I mean, the cheek of me, posters on the wall and holding my album, like in my mind, you know. And I remember saying to my brother, I'm not going tomorrow. And of course he went mad. He was like, but Frank got you a start. Are you mad? And I just went, give it to one of your mates. I'm not going. And then the next week I ended up singing in a bar called Minogue's in Islington by Ethel Minogue. And then that kick-started me singing for money. I started singing other people's songs. But then busking happened. I used to busk a lot in the underground. I mean, you took your life in your hands. Northern Irish accent. There was a lot of activity going on in London at that time. And I got punched in the face. I got kicked over. People roaring racist abuse at me because of my accent. And I would just kind of had like maybe one or two songs I could sing to. Will I play you one of
Yeah, I'd love to hear you.
Now, I played kind of sort of badly because I didn't really know it all, but this will tell you a lot. This is...
I'm so in love with you.
You know this, right?
Whatever you want to do is all right by me. Let me be the one you come running to. Oh, and I'll never be untrue. Let me say since.
So there I'd be standing there in the underground, you know, trying to remember those chords, singing a wee bit of Al Green, even a wee bit of gospel even then.
Are we getting the money in, Ray?
Yeah, sometimes I would get money, and then sometimes you'd get money and some skinhead would run along and grab it and nick it.
No.
You'd have none left.
No.
After like 2 hours of busking. I think the rule was from the moment another busker came along, you then had 1 hour. That was the kind of rule. I think these days it's really policed, isn't it? You have to really be careful. And not in these days, people have microphones and
speakers. Yes. Backing tracks and everything. Yes, yes.
Not in my day.
Different days. Brian, I want to take a break. But we have you in London now.
Yes, we're in London. We're established in London.
After the break, we'll find out what happens after you're in London.
We're very underweight and I'm about to be a stripper.
We'll be back in a couple of minutes. Welcome back. My special guest tonight is the fabulous Brian Kennedy. Brian, before the break, you mentioned something about male strippers.
I did.
You're not going to tell me. Sorry.
I'm afraid so. But in order to earn money when I was not busking, I joined a company called Giggles, right? And all I had to do was strip down to a G string. But the best part of the story is I had to go and audition in Putney. And who auditioned me? I'll give you a clue. Two big, baldy, muscle men who were brothers.
Out of EastEnders.
Right Said Fred.
Oh, right. I was thinking of the two baldy boys at EastEnders.
Oh, and the Mitchell brothers.
The Mitchell
brothers. No, Right Said Fred. And so they were, hello, come in, take your clothes off, you know, all that. And so I stripped down to this kind of G-string thing, and I did a couple of hen nights. So out there in the ether of the world, there are photographs of me basically naked and spreading. I was a crazy caveman, so I had to stick a big kind of club between my legs and chase these women around bars and things, as you do.
Long did that go on for?
Oh, and do you know why it didn't go on for very long? Because I didn't have a landline back before mobile phones. You had to have a landline to take the calls and take the bookings. And the squat that we then moved on to didn't have a phone line. I loved every second of it.
Thank God for no phone lines.
I know.
Thank God there was no phone lines in those days.
But I was 19 years old.
Yeah, and making money.
I'm making money, taking my clothes off. It was fun.
Let's talk about music.
That was an exclusive, by the way.
Let's talk about the music.
Okay.
How did that progress?
It progressed very strangely because I had become the lead singer, replaced the lead singer in my brother's band. We moved to London. Suddenly the reality of being poor in London, having to pay for rehearsal space, you know, somewhere nice to live perhaps, that took a few years to settle. And in the meantime, because I started busking by myself and all of that stuff, I started really getting used to singing on my own. And then I'd go back to the band and then I'll be smoking and, you know, all that kind of thing. And in a little rehearsal room this size, and I'd be like, oh God, you have to smoke in here. And we were literally like oil and water, you know, we just couldn't, no matter how much we tried. And very interestingly, by the time we got enough new songs together, my brother was the chief songwriter at the time.
Yeah.
We decided to do a gig in a bar in Hackney. This is our big, here we are. We've launched ourselves in London. My voice went completely because I'd been singing so hard over the noise of the electric guitars and amplifiers and all that. I woke up in the morning of the gig with no voice. It was nearly like, you know, the universe going, not today, not today. And so the band were very unforgiving about it, unfortunately. And it was yet another reason. By then, I also moved away to my own place, met some other people. I joined a gospel choir in Needston when I was 19 years old. So I had to take two tubes to go and rehearse with this fabulous big black gospel choir in Needston. The members of Rochford were in it, for example.
Did you still have this belief that you will be on the wall of somebody's presence at some stage?
I did, naively or otherwise. I started to think, I was looking around thinking, well, I mean, I just want to make my own music. I want to be a solo artist. This thing called a solo artist. I'd started play guitar a bit more seriously. Pat Gribben had given me a copy of Joni Mitchell's Blue, and that completely expanded my mind in terms of what was possible on acoustic guitar. I was so allergic to electric guitar at that point, you know.
All acoustic.
All acoustic.
Who spotted you?
Well, what happened was Pat Gribben and the Adventures, when they weren't busy, they had a kind of a covers band called the Dead Handsomes, and they played bars around Tottenham for fun, and they would get their mates up to guest. And I got up one Saturday and I sang, you don't have to be beautiful to turn me on. You remember Tom Jones had a version of it out? And I got up and chorus up on the table because I'd been stripping a little bit too. So I wasn't that shy, except fully clothed this time. And then apparently the girls from the office were there, and they went back to Simon Fuller's office and said, oh, we saw this great, fun, great fella the other night. And so he started to hear about me. And then we used to use the Adventures demo situation to make little recordings. And again, Pat would be playing things to Simon. And then one day out of the blue, Simon called me up and said, Simon Fuller, this is Simon Fuller. I'll never forget it. He said, I've heard too much about you now to ignore. And I was like, who's this? I'm 19 years old, the same age as his company, 19 Management. And I hung up on him. I was just like, yeah, right. Because I know, you know, in those days, people prank called people.
Who else was Simon Fuller looking after at the time?
At that time, let's see. Well, 19, Paul Hardcastle is where it came from, that management. Juliet, all kinds of amazing soul singers. Nobody absolutely huge yet, but he was about to manage Annie Lennox. Yes. He then was about to discover the Spice Girls, yes. S Club 7, David Beckham. You know, all of that whole thing, which he's still involved. And of course, invent this show called Pop Idol.
Yeah.
That was Simon's invention.
Yes, apparently.
And all of that.
Yeah.
So this was all going on in the ether. And I brought my guitar in and sat with him like this. And he said to me, have you got any songs? I went, yeah, here's a bit of one. And I just played him something on the guitar. And he was like, oh, I thought you were going to play me a cassette, a tape. And I was going, well, I haven't recorded anything yet. And he goes, do you want to record something next week? That's what he was like. It'd just be like, and all of a sudden, it was a sliding doors moment where I had to take kind of two buses and walk the King's Road and finally get to Battersea. And then suddenly my life changed like that.
What year are we talking about now? Where are we up to?
We were up to 1987, 88.
1987. Can I push it on to 1990?
Because
I remember well, you brought out a song called Capture.
Oh.
And you wrote the song?
I wrote the song with my friend Danny Mitchell.
Yeah.
Danny Mitchell wrote If I Was with Midgeur. Big number one songwriter.
And I remember you came on the Kelly Show.
I did.
1990 as a young boy.
Those were the things.
Could you relive that moment for
me? I'll try.
Could you try Capture it again? This was like written so early.
This is one of the first songs I ever demoed.
What a great song.
It's just one of those ones. And I hate to tell you what it's about.
I'll not ask you.
Oh, I just heard a melody, and it almost made me cry. My voice was filled with yearning, but that's not all. There's something else. No, that's not all. There's something else. Every word was in my ear, and every note crystal clear. Oh, how you've captured my heart. Oh, yes. Oh, how you've captured my heart. Ooh, ooh.
There's a wee bit of it.
Very, very.
Not bad. Was that your calling card then? Was that the introduction, really?
Well, that was the first song of mine that ever went to radio. I toured with Fairground Attraction and caused a wee bit of a stir, because as an unsigned artist, I had been championed by them. And then RCA ended up signing me. Tim Freeze Green, the renowned producer with Talk Talk, made the record. And suddenly, you would have been serviced that single, I suppose.
Yeah.
Along with amazing. I mean, I must say, thanks to you, Gerry Anderson, people like that, Ivan Little, you know, Ivan Martin, people who got on board early and thought, you know, and a lovely man called Joe Mack,
yeah,
who was out there making sure you played that record. Thank you, Joe Mack, for doing that. So really, it's ironically my home place that were the first people to put their arms around me.
Even though you were in London.
Even though I had to go to London to make something happen.
I understand.
Yeah.
Was the voice always the same? Was it always that voice that you have today?
Well, I think it's probably stronger now as an older man.
But you have that range.
I suppose. I remember a summer where I have a younger brother, Stuart, that we get on great, and I'd moved away. And so I rang the house for some reason, and this fella answered the phone like this. He was his voice in his boots, and his voice had broken during the summer.
Right.
But he's younger than me. But my voice was really sore for a summer, and then it went higher. I mean, work that out. Who knows? Oh. It's just what happened physically. And I always, do you know what's, I suppose the other answer really now is that when I was younger, I really only was really taken by women singers. So Kate Bush, you know, Joni Mitchell later on, Streisand, and I mean, the Clues were there early. But I was always trying to sing in their key.
Yes. Yes.
So unconsciously,
the voice sort of got.
I was always reaching for those notes rather than, it never occurred to me that boys shouldn't sing in that key.
Yeah.
So sure, what did I know?
Tell me about you and Van Morrison. How did you two get together?
Well, you know, again, this is like, it was like fate was waving at me, because my uncle Brian, who lived with the other granny, had the most amazing, incredible vinyl collection of Van Morrison, Joni, all these people, Dylan. And so I used to, you know, go in there and have a look and all that. Van heard me singing, I believe, when we tried to do a charity single for Northern Ireland called Peace Together, that project. And by then, I was asked to do a song with my brother's band. Now, we were deeply estranged at that point, even then. But I thought, no, come on. This is for Northern Ireland. Just never mind that nonsense. And we got together in a studio.
Sorry, you and Bob had fallen out at this stage.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did you ever say why you and Bob fell out?
Well, it was never. I wish it was a simple answer. I think it was a combination of childhood, of early adulthood, of Northern Ireland, of London, of sexuality, of, you know, differences of opinion. He was way more religious than I was and things like that. And I think a lot of factors. It's a really, really busy tapestry, that one.
Was it a fallout or was it a drifting apart?
It was a very purposeful drifting apart, I would say.
Okay.
And so we were asked to do this record. And so I thought, well, of course I'll go into the studio with him. It might be cool. It might be good fun, you know. And by then I'd had, you know, my record was, I felt more confident in myself too. So we went into the studio, hadn't seen each other for a good few years, and cut a song of Van's called Celtic Ray. You know, when the wind comes around. You know that one?
Yes.
Ireland, Scotland, England, the Wales, that one. That's great. Signature thing that happens. So in I went, we cut the song very quickly.
we were cordial to each other, but it wasn't very warm or friendly, but that's all right, you know. And then off we went. And then Van heard the recording of me singing the lead on that song, apparently, and asked to meet with me many, many months later. And so I met with him eventually in Kelly's bar here in Belfast, and we sat up all night talking, all the way through the night. I didn't drink in those days. I had a mineral water. I think Van didn't drink either at that point, actually. And so we just had a great a musical conversation. He was asked, like, how do you like? Who is your favorite singer? I'd be like, Sam Cooke. Sam Cooke, oh my God. You know, like, Let's Stay Together, You Send Me, all those amazing songs. And so we just had a really funny connection. And I thought that was it. And then shortly after that, I got an invite to come to a rehearsal he was having here. So off I went, and we did a few tunes together. We did a bit of Crazy Love. And I was very honest with him. He said to me, do you know my music? And I went, honestly, I don't really. Because I was a Joni fan.
Yes.
Bap was the one that was obsessed with that. So, and I think he kind of liked that, you know, honesty. And then we had a couple of bits of Let's Stay Together, bit of You Send Me, a wee bit of soul music. And then that was it. And I thought, okay, that was amazing. Wow, finally met that incredible man. On the way home, I get a phone call saying, Van would like you to come and sing with him in Wiltshire next week in England at the WOMAD Festival. And I'm like, really? Okay. So I eventually get to, this is the short version of the story. And he called me on in the middle of the set. Now, what was I going to sing? I don't know. He just felt like, a young friend from Belfast. We ended up doing Gloria, which I knew and I didn't really know. I knew the chorus. And he'd just done it with John Lee Hooker. So there was a call and answer thing. And so Van said to me, do you know Gloria? And I said, tell me the lyrics and I'll sing it. I mean, the neck on me for a start as well. But I didn't know what else to say. I was like, yeah, sing me the lyrics and I'll. So I made up this kind of blues.
It usually was G-L-O-R-I-A.
No, the verse. Want to tell you a story about a woman I know. You know that.
Yes.
Her name was G. You know that. So, but this is in front of about 80,000 people, you know. And so that went well. And then we did a bit of Crazy Love and Moon Dance, of course. And I was able to, I'm good at harmonizing because I would be harmonizing with ambulances when I was a little kid. I would be singing along with the radio. So that wasn't hard for me to do. I didn't realize that. I just would naturally good at it.
And how long did that last? Where did you
sing? 6 years around the world. I sang on 5 of his albums. I toured with Joni Mitchell, Bob Dylan. I mean, many, many times. Ray Charles, met the most incredible people. Like, one time, you know, we'd be sitting there, Robert De Niro was there at the side of stage, and we ended up going to dinner with Robert De Niro, Jack Nicholson, Roddy McDowell, all these amazing people, Richard Harris, extraordinary people like that. So I have so much to thank him for. He made sure I sing Crazy Love in the movie When a Man Loves a Woman. And even in the recent movie Belfast, I'm singing Days Like This with him in that movie. Really? I didn't know that either. Nor did I. Yeah. So I have a lot to thank him for. And when I got really sick, I have to tell you, he sent me the most beautiful card and a signed guitar for me to auction when the time is right.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
Uh-huh. So you obviously got on very well with
him. We got on great because I was able to just be myself.
Yeah.
I wasn't in the band. I was a guest part of this Blues and Soul review. So I always kind of nearly thought, well, the next gig will probably be my last gig. I also started getting really busy myself. My solo career was really beginning to get, you know, get traction.
So where does Riverdance fit into all this then?
Well, that's a funny one, you know. So it's 1999, right? I'm here. I've kind of had 2 number one albums. It's all gone very well. There's a rumor going around that I've been found in bed with another male singer from a boy band that you know all about and all that nonsense. So I'm starting to get distracted from just being a singer. Now I'm this kind of tabloid fodder, which is just so weird, you know. And then I remember Simon Fuller saying to me, we need something like a kind of a Riverdance or something. He literally said that. And within 2 weeks, we had 2 phone calls. One was from the office of Riverdance requesting a meeting. And the next day, the office of Andrew Lloyd Webber requesting a meeting with me and Simon. So the first people that called were Riverdance. We met with them first. And Bill Whelan and John McColgan came to our office, Simon's office, and said, Bill has written new music, new songs for this new spectacular version of Riverdance. I imagine they had their eye on a Tony. And Bill has written these songs, Brian, with your voice in mind. And so, again, to cut a long story short, I ended up moving to Manhattan not that long after that, and with a starring role in in the biggest musical at that time in history.
What were you singing?
I was singing, first of all, you would hear the voice of Liam Neeson.
Yeah.
You know, Adili Ushla, and Out of the Mist, and a Balamina accent. And then the mist would go down, everything would go kind of, and then you would see the kind of outline of an Irish prince. And then suddenly you would just kind of hear this,
Hear my cry and my hungering search for you. Taste my breath on the wind. See the sky as it mirrors my colors. Hints and whispers begin. I am living to nourish you, cherish you. I am pulsing the blood in your veins. Feel the magic and power of surrender to life.
And then the dancers would come on and the lights would come up and the show would start. I did that 8 times a week for 9 months. That fairy piece. All lovely, smoky and reverby and Liam Neeson-y.
You know that. Yeah. You love New York, didn't you?
I really loved it. When I think of it now, really, for many reasons, but I was 33 years old. So I was peaking in terms of physically. Couldn't have been fitter. I used to run all the time and all of that. And I'd get home just in time to see a double episode of The Golden Girls, you know, with a lovely glass of wine, you know yourself. And it was just a really exciting time in my life. I was living in a beautiful apartment. My neighbor was Monica Lewinsky. My other neighbor was, do you remember Dorothy of Lilith from Frasier? Frasier's wife.
Yeah.
So she was my other neighbor. Funny things, like they'd shoot Sex and the City in the gym downstairs. I saw Tom Cruise do a scene from Vanilla Sky at the top of the road. Like it was, you were literally living in a movie.
Well, what did you want for yourself at that stage? Where was Riverdale's going to take you to? What was the plan
that's
there?
That's a good question. It was a very interesting stepping stone of a sort. I remember Sinead O'Connor was in town and she was launching her beautiful album and I got invited to that. I was hanging out a little bit with her. I really wasn't sure what I was at because I'd had these hit records. I'm now in this massive musical, which is the best version of Groundhog Day you can think of because you literally do the same thing 8 times a week until, you know, I did that for 9 months, over 300 performances. But I did have my eye on what next. And so I started to write things that became Get On With Your Short Life, that album, Christopher Street. Songs like that started to come out of me. And I never would have written those songs had I not lived in Manhattan. So many, many great songs came out of it. The album Get On With Your Short Life. And then I ended up opening for the Coors on Broadway in Radio City because they were in town and they asked me, would I come and do a set? And I'll never forget it. Do you know who came to the show? Phil Ramone. Phil Ramone produced Sinatra, Streisand, the George Michael Beautiful album, the Sinead O'Connor covers album. He came to see me and he said to me, when you're ready, let's make an album together. I nearly died because, you know, he'd worked with the absolute best of the best. And then unfortunately, a couple of years later, he died. I never got to do it. So it was a really exciting...
That was a real pinch me moment, wasn't it?
Yeah. I remember when Donny Osmond came to my dressing room to say well done, and he'd recorded a song called At the Edge of the World, which was a brand new song of Bill Whelan's and all that, and then he brought me over to the studio to hear his version. It was all being filmed, and I remember crying my eyes out because my parents would not let me watch the Osmonds on the TV because it was too girly. And then I was thinking, see, now there's Donny in my dressing room. So I went out of my way, actually. I got Donny to write something to my sister because she was a bigger fan than I was, even of the Osmonds.
So at that stage, Brian Kennedy, you were the pin-up boy in people's bedrooms.
Was I?
Absolutely. Well, look, you've just described to me what you'd done to this stage.
I suppose I never thought about it like that. Like, I never could imagine. I could imagine my poster on a street of my album cover. That was my ridiculous fantasy of myself.
That was a pin-up in somebody's bedroom.
I suppose so. I never thought about those kind of things because that wasn't where my thing was. I never wanted to be famous. I did a bit. But I wanted to be famous so that I make it easier to make records and go on tour. That was my goal.
Were you chasing money as well?
A little bit, because I grew up without any, really. So there's nothing more wonderful than being able to say to your friends, no, I'll get dinner. No, I'll do that. And so that's really exciting when you start to do that kind of stuff in your life. And also the working class dream of finally owning your own home, somewhere that you can call your own. And when those things happened, it was really extraordinary to be able to turn a key in a in the door and go, this is my flat, this is my gorgeous flat in London, this is my amazing wee house in Dublin or whatever it is. So yeah, there was a kind of great excitement about that. And Paul Simon has a wonderful song that talks about it's proof that really matters. You know, when you have proof, when you look at a platinum disc, yes, rather than dreaming of one, and you've got not one but several, and all of that, and now other people coming up and saying,
yeah, it's validation.
It's validation. It's proof that
of your talent.
Yeah, because I drove people mental saying, I'm going to be a singer, I'm going to move to London, I'm going to do this, and my friends were just like, oh God, shut up already, you know. And finally, it happened.
I want to jump again.
Go on then. You old kangaroo, you.
To the George Best funeral.
All right.
That you were asked to sing at George
Best. Yes, I was.
And you sang a song called?
I sang a song called You Raise Me Up. Yeah. And the amazing thing about that song is that it was only written this century. Yeah. Think about that for a minute.
You do feel that it's,
you feel like
old,
it's
old song.
Old, old song. And of course, you feel like it's a kind of a love letter to Danny Boy in a small kind of a way. And I had been contacted out of the blue again by Brendan Graham and a group called Secret Garden.
Yes.
Who I confused with Savage Garden in my mind. And so I thought, well, they have a wonderful single called Darren, what, you know. Anyway, so they invited me down to sing on this brand new record. They'd won the Eurovision, just to give you context. And so they were, this is their follow-up album, Once in a Red Moon. And they had this song, like I said, it was sort of a love letter to Danny Boy, but wasn't. It was an original song. And Brendan Graham wrote this lyric because it was an instrumental. And so I remember hearing a tape of it. Let me see. I have to, it's like Danny Boy in that if you started in the wrong key, you're in big trouble. So kind of a,
When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You can sing it with me if you want. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
It's a small version of it. It's much longer than that.
Thank you. That charted, you charted with that, didn't you?
That is my, I'm very proud to tell you, Gerry Kelly, that is my biggest chart hit to date. And it's a live recording from the George Best funeral in Stormont. And that's what they put out as this fundraiser.
Okay.
And so so far, my biggest hit is a live recording from Stormont. I kind of love that.
Westlife sort of surpassed you though, didn't it?
Well, no, Josh Groban first.
Oh, Josh
Groban. He got a hold of it
first
in America.
Yes.
There's maybe over 1,000 people that have covered it now. Yes, Westlife in the UK, absolutely. All kinds of people all over the world. It's the most covered song, I think, in its young life, you know, well over 1,000 people. But I am the first, the original.
And with that, we'll take another break. We'll be back in a minute or two. And welcome back. My special guest, of course, tonight is Brian Kennedy. Brian, we've got you up to about 2006, I think we are now.
Oh, well done.
And there was a sort of change in direction again for you because you were asked to perform in the Eurovision Song Contest.
Yes.
But this wasn't where you were heading, surely.
Not at all. I mean, it came right, you know, it was such a weird angle it came from because it never would have occurred to me to get involved with Eurovision. Other than, I suppose, you know, back in the day with Mihola Sulawong, we did the interval part. You might remember that, Lumen,
after Riverdance happened,
way before I was connected at all with Riverdance. So again, it's kind of like if you don't believe that there's a plan for you, occasionally things come along and go, oh, well, maybe there is. So when I was first asked, I just thought, really? Eurovision? And then the more I thought about it, the more I thought, you know, people are can be so kind of snobby about it. And a few people were going, oh, God, please don't do that. That would be so naff and awful. And other people were saying, that's exactly why you should do it, because it would
be so unexpected of you.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I sat down and I thought, how many times do you get to represent your country at anything? Because the moment I said yes, and my song won the heat to represent, and I arrived in Athens, I was no longer Brian Kennedy. I was Ireland. Hello, Ireland. How are you? Welcome. Oh, Ireland is here, everybody. So it's not lost on you that you're representing your country at every turn. And also with my own song, I wrote it with Callum McCall, the wonderful Callum McCall, who you know. And just it was just such fun. Now, it was hard work because you from the moment you arrive, everything's recorded. Everything. You know, cause it's that's when camera phones really were kicking off. So every rehearsal's recorded because these are all the extras for the DVD later on. So you are aware, like, well, I suppose I could sort of half show up with a bit of a beard and scruffy pants, but you can't really do that. And so, again, like I say, I thought to myself, Brian, this is probably the campest chapter in your career so far. You know, you thought being a stripper was camp. Now, all of a sudden, now I'm representing our country. So I loved it. I got us out of the semi-final. The very funny moment because, you know, we were not in the final yet. And they called my name out last for the final place.
Really?
For the final. And if you look it up on YouTube, ladies and gentlemen, you will see me miming the following two words.
Would you stop mime but sing a bit?
Oh, yeah.
Of the song?
I think it's in G, I think.
Every song is a cry for love, would you say?
Every song is a cry for love. Every voice can arise above. So don't be afraid. Just show what you're made of. Sing it out. Every song is a cry for love. And then, oh, it goes. I even went down on one knee. Do you remember that?
I do remember that.
Oh, every time we did a rehearsal.
What were you wearing?
I was wearing Dolce and Gabbana. I do remember that, I think.
Yeah.
A shiny satin black jacket.
I have an image of this. Yes, I have an image of
yeah.
Yeah.
Back in the, I'm kind of older and wider these days. So I don't try that jacket on or those pants. But yeah, it was, again, I was in my 30s. It was a good time to be doing something like that. And honestly, I love a bit of surprising career moving. I mean, why not? I look back on it now with pride.
I want to get slightly more personal with you now, if you don't mind.
Should I lean forward? Okay.
No, you're well just answering.
I am.
Of course. When did you decide that you'd come out to say, I am a gay man?
Well, it was a very slow process, I would say. Because when you're a gay man from this part of the world, unfortunately, the dictionary that you're handed has already been written for you. And all of the definitions that you're looking up to see what these things mean have the most awful connotations written by someone else. They actually don't, they're not true. So it took us the longest time to make sure that the word gay was no longer synonymous with paedophile or those kind of things. I mean, there were never any same-sex examples around us, you know. It was maybe, you know, Paddy and Johnny, the two old, you know, hill bachelors and all that kind of thing, or two old sisters that never married and, you know, all those kind of things. So there was never any kind of positive influence around it all. So I was very, again, here's how smart I was. I knew when to be stupid. That's how I measure smartness, when you know when to be stupid. So I would pretend I didn't know what anybody was talking about. But of course, like I said, people were pointing it out to me. I had this lovely wavy curly hair and big eyelashes, and people would say, oh, that wee girl's lovely, isn't she? And she's a lovely voice and all of that stuff. And or the opposite, which is shut your mouth, you're a girl. You're only an old girl. It was such a weird position to occupy as a young person. So slowly but surely, I remember seeing things like The Naked Civil Servant on the television. And again, can't relate, but can relate. I was excited. I met Quentin Crisp years later in New York. That's a whole nother Gerry Kelly show. But certainly, slowly but surely, it was an unfortunate time because by the time I became a young man in London, the first pandemic that ever hit us was HIV and AIDS. So it was a very terrifying time. But I went into psychotherapy very deeply because of the family situation and because of my own situation. And that really helped me come out. But it's the best thing I ever did. I did it artistically. I would say to anybody at home still struggling with it, in order to be your authentic self, you have to occupy who you are. And currently speaking, you know, it's a great place to be for me to be a gay person in this world. It's a part of me. It's a large part of me. But it's not the whole of me. I'm a singer and an artist and all the other things I do. But I'm very, very happy, man. I happen to fancy fellas. I love women. You know, I have great relationships with women. I had, you know, bits of sex with women over the years, and that was fun too. But I was being dishonest in that moment, and I would rather live an honest life myself.
Did it damage your career? Did it enhance your career?
Well, I was warned wholeheartedly not to mention it in the very, very early days, because suddenly my audience were young girls and young women and a lot of that. And very definitely it was kind of like, yeah, we might not mention that stuff. And we may maybe get your foot. Like when I did, if I can say it, I did Hello Magazine at home with Brian Kennedy, and they made me do it with a friend of mine who was a woman to make it look like she was my girlfriend. And no uncertain terms. And I'll say allegedly, I suppose I have to say allegedly, maybe cut out hello. But the message was very clear. We don't do men on their own.
Really?
Yeah.
But you're happy in your own skin today. Very happy in your own skin.
Well, there's a wee bit more of it than I used to have.
Join the club.
Yes, I am.
Join the club. How's the health? Because you had an awful fear recently.
I mean, what a dunt, as my friend would say in Donegal. What a dunt. Yeah, look, as I sit here now, I'm 5 years all clear of cancer officially. I'm also 2.5 years all clear of the quadruple heart bypass that was a consequence of a bit of chemo and who knows what else. And I... You know, good days, bad days. I'm certainly not the man I was. I have a new song called I'm Not the Man I Was, because I'm also older. I get more tired more easily, things like that. But I mind myself. But I also let my hair down too. And I know when to have fun. But, you know, all the rules have changed. And especially when you have two bags like I do, the colostomy and the urostomy bag, that old life is gone. And now there's a new life.
Are they permanent?
Completely permanent. I will be... I don't know how I'm going to be better. I think I'll leave my body to science, because I think that maybe surgeons could then practice on cutting me up a bit, and that would make them better surgeons, right? And also, apparently, then they cremate you for free.
Really?
That's the deal, apparently. So yeah, I'm a bit of a. In Dublin, they call me the bag ambassador.
The bag ambassador.
Yeah.
During all your problems, were you frightened?
Yeah. I absolutely was, because I didn't know what I was getting into. And quite rightly, there's only a certain amount of information that the medical team will tell you, because it's so overwhelming.
What were you frightened of?
Pain, being in too much pain.
Not of dying?
No, I think, because I won't know I'm dead. I mean, I also have to tell you, I've been dead. When I had my quadruple heart bypass, they stop your heart and they rewire you from the veins in your leg, and then they hopefully start your heart again, and my heart started straight away again. So I've been dead. There's nothing there. We're just dead.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you lost all your religion?
I never really had it in an authentic way. I did it because I had to have it. Again, it was one of those times in my life where I thought, if I play by the rules, I won't be punched and kicked as much as I could be. And also, as we know, the church held all the power. I mean, I think my mother got the rent book off the local priest for the house that we were in. So they had all the power. So you have to know where the mines are so you can avoid them. But also, I also have a great faith in faith. I think faith is a wonderful thing. It's a very comforting thing for people. I know some wonderful priests, some wonderful members of the church. Church buildings are some of my favourite buildings to sing in. And if you genuinely are comforted, especially at a time of loss, by your local church, by your local priest, that's a wonderful thing.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
But at the moment, health-wise, you are well on your way.
You're stuck with me for another while, Gerry, I'm afraid.
That is great. I want to be on the positive note. You mentioned the fallout with your brother, Bap.
Yeah.
And Bap died. But before Bap died,
yes,
you reconciled.
I did. I heard that he was terminal, and we got a terrible shock, you know. And he was diagnosed in the May. I was diagnosed in June, and he only lasted 5 months after that.
Yeah.
So I absolutely, my motto is, don't worry about what's right or what's wrong. What's the kind thing to do? And I've set myself beside that.
That's nice. That's nice. And you reckon so?
We did. We had a chat for about an hour. He was very weak and very unwell. But we had a kind of a funny, bizarre kind of little chat about music and different things. We didn't touch on any past things or anything. There was no point in doing that.
But you know, everybody that knew the two, they were delighted when they heard that news.
Oh, that's good.
That the two of you.
Do you know what's lovely? If I hear him now on the radio, it makes me smile.
Oh, that's nice.
That's what I do now.
There's a song of yours that made President smile. President Clinton smiles, apparently, and listens. Oh, you singing one particular song.
Oh, right. Is that true?
That is true.
Oh, right.
And the song is Carrick Fergus.
Is it really?
Uh-huh. He smiles and loves Carrick Fergus. So, Brian, can I thank you?
Yeah, you
for
can.
Being my guest tonight. Sure. I thoroughly enjoyed the chat. Will you see us out with Carrick Fergus?
I'd love to. And now I remember what you're talking about. I sung for Mr. Clinton a bunch of times. And all I will say about Mr. Clinton is, you would.
He's taller than you.
I wish
I was in Carrickfergus only 4 nights in Ballygran. I would swim over the deepest ocean, the deepest ocean, for my love to find. But the sea is wide and I cannot swim over, nor have I the wings to fly. But I wish I could find on some boatman to ferry me over to my love and I. My childhood days bring back sad reflections of happy times I spent so long ago. My boyhood friends and my own relations have all passed on now like melting snow. But I'll spend my days in endless roaming, soft as the grass, my bed is free. To be back now in Carrickfergus on that long road down to the sea. And in Belfast on the Gerry Kelly Show, it is reported there are marble stones as black as ink, with gold and silver, I would support her. But I'll sing no more now till I get a drink. Sure, I'm drunk today, and I'm seldom sober. A handsome rover from town to town. But I'm sick now and my days are numbered. So come all ye young men and lay me down.
What a way to finish. Good night, everybody. Good night.